James exhorts us to endure temptation, and how then in enduring temptation we're called to confess that God is good, that He doesn't tempt anyone, that we are evil, that we are the ones drawn away by our evil desires, and how every time we're drawn away like that, enticed, and sin conceives, then it bears, it brings forth death. And we talked about sort of like this steps or progression into sin, into actual acts of sin that begins with the sinful desires, right? So we said that right there we ought to be confessing our sins. And it's interesting that according to James, we are confessing that we are being drawn away and tempted of our own sinfulness, so that we are exempting God. In other words, we are justifying God with our confession. With our confession of sin, we are saying, like David would say, right? That you may be right when you judge, right? So our confession of sin is acknowledging you are right, God, and I am not. You are good and I am evil. And I have sinned, or I am drawn into sin out of my lack of trust for you, my distrust of your goodness. So in confessing that, we are affirming the goodness of God. We are affirming the wisdom, the righteousness, the justice of God, while we are then, on the contrary, abasing ourselves, humbling ourselves, right? So we saw that we should do it when we are drawn by our sinful desires. We should do it then when sinful desires or concupiscence have conceived. And we said that, I believe what it's the reference here to sin being conceived, right? When, notice verse 15, when desire has conceived. That's 1:15. So 14 says, we're drawn away by our own desires and enticed. But then 15 says, when desire has conceived. So notice that progression there from the sinful desire. And we said that the sinful desire is a deceitful desire, putting Paul's language, right, in back of James. So a sinful desire is a deceitful desire because the inclination and the enticing comes with a voice, with it, with an argument that says, go ahead and obey this sinful desire because there's something here that God is not, is failing to give you, that God is not providing for you. There's something that God is not sufficient for that you need to get by following, right, the prompting, the suggestion, the leading of the sinful desire.
I have a question.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I have the King James version.
Okay.
The King James version.
Yeah.
And in mine it says here, then when lust has conceived,
yeah,
it brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death.
Right.
So just to have a thought here.
Sure.
When Adam and Eve, when if Adam would have had just thought about it,
yeah,
it still bring death, even though he thought about it?
Definitely, Adam. Adam's sin consisted in the thought, the desire, and the partaking.
But what I'm saying is, let's say he just thought about it, but it never.
Okay.
Action,
okay.
The action wasn't there.
Here's the thing. Adam without sin had no sinful thoughts. You see? Adam without sin had no sinful thoughts. He didn't know what evil was. He couldn't even think about it because he didn't know what it was. You see? So the moment he has a sinful thought, that goes right in with the action. So you cannot disconnect. We disconnect them now in the analysis, okay? But a sinful action is always preceded, accompanied by a sinful thought and a sinful desire. In other words, the thought in him caused the desire to break forth for sinning, for sin, which in that case was to go contrary to God's will, under temptation.
Even though he didn't know what evil was.
No, but now he considered what evil, he didn't know experientially, okay? He didn't know experientially, but under the temptation, he gave it thought, right? And believed it and acted upon it. You see? So that is the progression of sin. So you entertain it, okay? Obviously, he didn't have a sinful nature at the time, right? So he doesn't have, he's not being drawn by a sinful desire from within. He has no sinful desire. He's never had a sinful thought. He's never had a sinful deed, right? He is without sin. So under that temptation, all of this breaks forth in his life. It's like the Big Bang of sorts, like an explosion where all of a sudden you have a being that was not sinning, not thinking sinful thoughts, not having sinful desires, and now he goes to thinking sinful thoughts, being drawn away by the desire, right, of that thought and committing the outward action.
Yeah, it goes back to now that you're saying that to what Jesus says. If you look at a woman in a lustful way, you commit adultery.
Right.
Even though you physically have
yeah. It. Now, our situation, we must make a distinction here now in the sense that now we are born, which, in other words, we must allow for Adam, for there to have been a time when Adam did not have any sin. He was created good, right? So what does that mean? He was created without the sin that the law describes. So he didn't have sinful desires. And he had not committed sinful deeds, right? So under temptation, this breaks forth inside of him, right? Which leads to the outward action. They go hand in hand. They go. It's not like he could have had the thought and the desire without committing the action. You see what I'm saying? So it was in the presence of the temptation that all of this broke forth in him. What you see broken down here, it's rising up in the creature, in the human creature for the first time. Does that make sense? It's rising up there for the first time. It's coming to be for the first time. Why? Because it was possible for him to sin. It was possible for him, right, to sin, believing the lie of Satan. And by believing the lie of Satan, questioning God's goodness and God's word, and God's provision, right? Then acting upon it with sinful desires and actions.
Well, the same with Lucifer, right?
We don't hear a lot about Lucifer, but we don't get a lot of information about Satan other than he also sinned. Other than he also, in his case, yeah, it was pride. It was the fact that he thought himself more worthy than God to rule, to have the place of honor, right? So for us now, it's different than for Adam, because we are born with this sinful genetics within us. It's already there. So it's only when we are, we don't know at what point this begins to manifest itself, but we know that it's there. And then, you know, children begin to be conscious because of their rational processes being developed of sin.
Yeah, we see that with their kids.
Right, right. Of right and wrong, and they are being drawn to do wrong by sinful desires. You see? So we are drawn then because we have these sinful desires, which means we have a sinful way of thinking. So it's all connected, right? We are saying sinful desires are deceitful desires. That's what Paul says. He says it in Ephesians. If you go to Ephesians, I think it's Ephesians 5. Ephesians 5, somewhere along here, I think it's 5, but it might not be 5, let me see. It's supposed to say, put off the sin, here it is. It's Ephesians 4, I'm sorry, Ephesians 4, 22. That you put off, concerning your former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful desires or lusts, in the case of King James, right? It's the same word, okay?
Desire sounds more
Yeah, and then also in the Spanish you have pasiones. Yeah. Pasiones, so it's passions, it's desires. That's basically what it means. Okay, so you see that there, deceitful, which grows corrupt according to the, this. What does it say in your Bible?
In Spanish.
No, in his. Yeah. Right. See that, deceitful lusts. Engañosos, right. Deceitful lusts, deceitful desires. So when you come back to James 1:14, you hear when he's drawn away by his own desires, right? So we know that those desires are deceitful desires.
Deceitful because I could have a desire to feed children.
Of course, yeah. Of course. Yeah. It's the same. As a matter of fact, the same word when the Bible says, when in Galatians 5, that the flesh desires against the spirit and the spirit desires against the flesh. It's the same word. It's the same word. As a matter of fact, some translations have it, the flesh lusts against the spirit and the spirit lusts against the flesh. So the spirit also brings desires, but they're holy affections, holy desires. You see? They're not deceitful desires. They are desires according to truth, as opposed to sinful desires, desires according to the lie, right? Deceitful desires according to error. According to the deceptive ways of Satan, sin, and the flesh. So, when then could we say, and that's what we were saying, that this deceitful desire conceives? Well, when we believe it. When we believe it. Right? It conceives what? It conceives a specific sinful deed. It doesn't mean that sin is not there. In the sinful desire, you already have sin. The sinful desire is sin in itself. How do we know that? Because the Ten Commandments prohibits it. Prohibits them. Because the Ten Commandments says, thou shalt not desire what? The things that are contrary to God. Thou shalt not desire. Well, that is why. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I walked right in.
Yeah. Because what have we been saying on Sundays? We've been talking about stories, right? And narratives. And what have we been saying about that? Why do we need to have our stories, our personal stories, our we never win stories, elevated and framed by the grand story of redemption? Because if we don't, we think and believe that we're not winning. And that we haven't won. And that we're losing. And that it's hopeless. But there's a bigger story than our story. And we're saying that is why we must come to the Bible. And the Bible wants to catch our story and bring our story into God's story rather than the other way around. We were using the analogy of that when we want to bring God's story into our story, it's like putting a big feet in a small shoe, right? Have you ever worn tight shoes, right? So when we are trying to make sense of God's story in light of my story, what happens more often than not? Gosh, why is this happening to me? And why did I lose my job? And why did I get cancer? And why did this happen? And why do I feel like this? And why they talk about victory and it seems like it eludes me? And why do I keep stumbling? You know, and right? And we are trying to listen to God's story, but through the filter of what? Of my little story. Okay, the Bible suggests a different course that is backwards. It's reading my story in light of God's story. And what we said last Sunday is that is why the Bible teaches covenant theology. For example, in the book of Romans, it talks about two heads. And it says that because of the disobedience of the first Adam, sin entered the world. And we have inherited the corruption and the death of the first Adam. But because of the obedience of the second Adam, right? Death and the curse of death has been defeated. And we can hope because of the person and the work of the second Adam. Notice then that it brings us a grand narrative that it doesn't first propose that we look at our story. But it calls for us to look at God's story. And then to place us and all our little stories within the framework of God's story. Because if I do that, then I know that sin is something not just... See, if I do it the other way around, I'm trying to make sense of God's story through my story. I'm saying, oh my goodness, okay, Adam sinned, but now here I am sinning. I got to fix it. I got to do this, I got to do that. You know, and I'm going to have victory because I'm going to do this. And now I believe in Jesus and I'm going to do all these things. And what am I doing? I'm trying to... My story is the driving framework. Whereas if I all of a sudden see the big picture, say, oh, wait a second. I'm not the main actor here. As a matter of fact, I stand in my human nature, in my fallenness, In my flesh, I stand in the first Adam. The reason that I am like this and the world is like this, it's not something that I can fix or anyone can fix, because it's the fall and the ruin of the first Adam. And that can only be undone, and that can only be defeated, not by my works and by my doing and by my resolve and my commitments and my decisions. That is undone by the person and the work of the second Adam, Jesus Christ. And he overcame sin and death on the cross. And he bound Satan on the cross. And he despoiled Satan by his death on the cross. And he ascended unto heaven after resurrecting. And he sits at the right hand of God. You see? And because of what is done, I begin to put my life story in that framework. And then it expands my mind to say, I may be suffering, this may have happened, but Jesus Christ won. He's the one sitting at the right hand. He's the one in whom I have the victory. He's the one who has promised me. It's because of his doing that I can wait. It's because of all that he has done that I am accepted by the Father. It's because of his righteousness that I can approach the throne of grace. So I'm not abandoning my story, but my story is being reframed by the story of another. The gospel, redemptive, grand narrative story. And then God is drawing me into his story and causing me then to participate in his life, in his story. Does that make sense? That I want to submit to you is what is so fundamentally wrong about the evangelical church today. They lack the grand view, the grand narrative picture of God's story. So,
That's why you have to die.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. And this requires a reframing of our minds. A reframing of our minds that when it is actually embraced, brings great power. Because
Freedom.
The power comes because of that freedom.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That freedom empowers you. That freedom transforms you. Because now you know that it's not just you and your little circumstances and your little life and your little story. And that is the center of the world. Even though your life is very important. But that your life is part of a greater whole, of a bigger picture. And that all the burdens and the things that we take upon ourselves, someone else.
For instance, there's a lot of people, the gentleman from Australia that was born without the arms and the legs.
Mm-hmm.
The young lady that had the shark in her arm, and she went out. These little people, these tragic things that
right. Yeah. That's the only
the little piece of the story that rippled and caused all this.
Sure.
And God's story.
Mm-hmm. Right. So, yeah. So we're always trying to make sense. Why it highlights that stories are important. Because and that's why the Bible is not just a manual of how to do things. The Bible is fundamentally a story. It's a story. Yes, it has a lot of different genres and different ways in which it puts it. And it has commandments and it has precepts, but it's a narrative. It's his story. It's a story of God's redemptive love. It's a story of a people forsaken and in darkness. And rightfully so, yet of a rescue from outside that world. It's a story by which we do, or people have been inspired to do all kinds of myths, right? Of the prince and the princes in the tower, and all of those stories of old, right? That has somebody locked up in misery, bound in prison, and somebody from outside coming to rescue, right? That is the longing of our hearts, even though we may not be aware of it. The problem is that we want to rescue ourselves. And that's the pull of the flesh. We want to rescue ourselves. And conversion and being born again is being opening our eyes to the realization that living our lives is a life lived by the rescue of another, by the love of another, by the redeeming presence of another, by being loved by another, by being gifted life. So I call it gift living. You can either live on the basis of gift living or on the basis of works living. The basis of gift living on the basis of works living. By the way, it's going to be in my dissertation when it comes out. So gift living is the fact that God ordained reality for him to be the provider. The one that gives you all things. That we have that in James, right? God is the giver of every good and perfect gift. It's there in verse 17. Every good gift. Notice how after he's talked about the progression of sin, all of a sudden he brings us to this reality, right? Almost as if to say, hey, I know this sounds very depressing because the story of our sinning and our being mired in sin is depressing, is sad, isn't it? But all of a sudden, he brings us down. He makes us, God makes us a sinner only to gift us deliverance. Only to gift us freedom from it. Right? So the progression of sin, our desires, our sinful desires, right? Sinful desires suggest a program, a mindset. What is that? Can't trust God. God is not good to you. He's let you down. You have to take matters into your own hands. Become your own God. That's idolatry. Idolatry is anything we think is things outside, but idolatry is a projection of self, of a self that concludes, I can't trust God, I need to trust money. I can't trust God, I need to trust security. I can't trust God, I need to trust power, right? Notice, those idols, they are reflections and projections of a self that cannot trust God. So every sin that we commit flows from that. It flows from a sinful desire who is suggesting, who is saying, can't trust God. And as a result of that sinful desire and that sinful thought of distrust in God's goodness, then sin is conceived when we believe it. And once we believe it, it's only a matter of time before we're acting upon it. So what do we do in the midst of all of that? Now James says, hey, don't be deceived by all of that. There is a fountain of goodness for you. You see how James fights sin? It's interesting. He uses a different type of language, but it's the same way that Paul recommends and gives us the framework for fighting sin. The Bible says it is the goodness of God, Paul says in Romans chapter 2, it is the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. Where is that found? Lest you think that, okay, Romans chapter 2. In Romans chapter 2, we hear, Romans chapter 2, verse 4. Or do you despise the riches of his goodness? You see that? Or do you despise the riches of his goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads you to repentance? You see that? What keeps us from repentance It's not believing the goodness of God, not trusting the goodness of God, and trusting the lies behind our sinful desires, right? So James is saying the same thing, but he puts it like this: hey, don't be deceived. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation of shadow of turning. Will you believe the Father? Right? Will you trust Him in the midst of your trials, he's saying? In the midst of your temptations and battles with sin, will you trust the good Father? Why can we trust Him? He, of verse 18, of His own will, He brought us forth by the word of truth. The word of truth is the gospel, right? The word of truth, and what is the word of truth? The gospel. The gospel is good news again, right? It's the goodness of God demonstrated at the cross. For God demonstrates His love for us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. Notice, for the ungodly. So if you try to get godly in order to get God's goodness, that is works living. No. God's gifts are for those who cannot do anything to deserve it, for the ungodly. Will you confess to your ungodliness? That's what James is doing. Confess. Make yourself ungodly. The reason I've repeated that, because I've been reading Luther's Theology of the Cross. And Luther so insightfully concludes that before God makes you a saint, He makes you a sinner. Before God gives you life, He kills you. Before God binds the wound, He makes the wound. Before God justifies you, He condemns you. Before God brings you high and exalts you, He humbles you and brings you low. Before God heals you, He breaks you down. That's why at some point He called righteousness, He identified it with humilita fides. Obviously, this was not still the mature Luther, who eventually arrives at a forensic view of justification, but he was on to something, big time on to something. Whereas the Middle Ages and the Scholastics were talking about habits of grace and habits and virtues in one, following Aristotle, and we become good by doing good and this and that, Luther says, you're all crazy. You're all so drunk with the wisdom of the world. For it pleased God to save the world by the foolishness of preaching. And then he says, God is a hidden God. That's what prophet Isaiah says. You are a hidden God. This is just deep stuff, isn't it? It's amazing stuff. He says, yes, the righteousness of God is revealed, but it's hidden. And where is it hidden? In the cross. In the cross, whoever wants to know God cannot know God by his plain reason or moral abilities. Those that want to know God by their pure reason and moral abilities will never know God. And then Luther calls them theologians of glory. He says, the theologians of the cross are those that know God in the hiddenness of God, yet in that hiddenness, in the cross, they come to realize that in the foolishness of God is His wisdom, that in the weakness of God is His strength. And then He takes everything and turns it upside down. So when you see Christ at the cross, suffering and rejected and cast aside, there is the glory of God. You know, the things that don't appear to be what people are after, and the glory and the things that are attractive to the eyes and seem low and foolish and death, you know, therein lies the glorious things of God. And it checks out. Once you start comparing and doing the exegesis of passages, Paul says that in I will glory in my infirmities, in my weakness, because when I am weak, I am strong. It pleased God to save the world by the foolishness of preaching, right? What eye has not seen, ear has not heard, God has prepared to those who love him. And so forth and so on, right? You have all kinds of these paradoxical, seemingly paradoxical statements in the Bible, such as, she who had no children has borne many. Those that had no bread have had their fill. And those that had abundance had hired themselves for bread. Those that were mighty, their bow has been broken. And those that have no strength have been strengthened. Those that were low are sitting now with princes. And those that were mighty are now in the dust. So those kinds of reversals, right, are the things that the gospel reveals. Why? Because the story of our flesh, our protagonism, our works must be put to death. And God does it so fittingly through the cross. And he does it, and he does it by the telling of a story. By the narrative of his word. His word is alive. When we speak it, when we proclaim it, when the gospel is being given, when the cross, when Christ crucified is being proclaimed, the flesh is being put to death. And a new creature is arising by the preaching of the death of Christ, in which is the humbling of all my glory and my shine. Right, that tells me, you know, I want to bring my story of glory, and God says, death to it. And then I want to raise myself, and God says, lay in the tomb. I alone can raise you. And he's doing all that by saying, look to me, look to me. You cannot even kill yourself. You cannot even put to death your own flesh. I put it to death. This is another of Luther's insights. It says that it is God that does these things. It's not what we do. The monks and the monasteries and the cloisters were all trying to do these things to kill themselves, to mortify the flesh, to appease God, to work works of contrition. And Luther realizes that it's all the glory of man. If we can only look to the cross and in that cross see our death, see that we have nothing, so we must be then completely humbled, die. And that is the doing of the Spirit that causes us to see our death and actually experience it through repentance and faith in the larger story of Christ dying our death and rising for our justification, our new life before God. Does that make sense? So that is why we need to keep hearing the story. You know. Yes. Thank you. That's a good way of putting it. To chip away at ours. Because ours is always mounting a comeback. Man, it's stubborn. Yeah. I like the way Luther talked to himself and said, oh, death, I have a death that kills you. You know, and he, and that's what we see the psalmist do. That's what prayer and meditation is. It's more than even prayer, folks. It's meditating on this word. It's living this word daily. Living with it, walking with it. That's when we live and walk with the Word, we live and walk with God. God lives and walks with us. As the good old hymn says, He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. But, you know, be careful because he lives within my heart, but my heart is too little for his story, so I live within his heart. Some hymns are affected by a little bit of the, the human condition, true, but also it depends on what tradition they come from. And if they come more from the Methodist, this type of other branch that eventually took its own way. But it wasn't as bad back then. You know, we know that there was a split later on from the Anglican reformers, right? And then John Wesley went his own way. And good things and good hymns, we're not saying that. But indeed, we always have to be reforming in a way. And I would say this way of reforming is by coming before God, before his word. That's why we're in Hebrews chapter 4 saying the word of God is. Let's just go there since we have ruined our class for tonight. Just kidding. Hebrews 4, because I got away from James. In Hebrews 4 it says, Hebrews 4 verse 11, verse 12 it says, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerning of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Notice, the word of God is compared to what?
Sword.
To a sword. And what is a, what was a sword used for? To kill. To kill. Yeah, to cut, but not to cut as in a... Yeah, so what God is saying here, notice that he's talking about rest. He's talking about rest, but in order to rest, notice what it's saying here. Verse 10, he who has entered his rest has himself also ceased from his works as God did from his. That's verse 10, right? So, from what works do we need to rest? From all of our works. Why? But Pastor, aren't some of those works good? Our works, what we do in our of our own power and intentions and strength and our own flesh is take the good works of God, and as soon as we touch it, we have corrupted it. So we take the good law of God and we corrupt it and we bring it down and we change it. We take the good creation of God and we corrupt it. We take marriage and we corrupt it. We take every good gift of God and we corrupt it. That's what our stories do. So God says, I only have one way of dealing with you. And what is that way? I got to kill you. Yeah. And what he has done is, he has killed the Son for us. Get it? That's the righteousness of God revealed in the gospel. Because in the killing of the Son, in that story we hear, we must be killed. And he grants us faith to believe that, to repent, to truly then be convicted and be sorrowful and be humbled and contrite and say, yes, indeed, oh, woe is me. Depart from me, O God, for I am a sinner. I am the first of sinners. Nothing good dwells in my flesh. That is the sword at its finest. And whoever experiences the power of that sword like that, then he leads you to verse 14. Notice after the sword has worked, then what picture do you get in verses 14 and 15 and through 16? seeing then that we have, notice what I want you to see is the movement, okay? The movement. With if you are trespassed by a sword, do you move up or down? You move down, you fall, you drop, right? You drop dead. But now notice this movement. Verse 14, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens. Where's the movement now? Up. It's death and resurrection. It's the movement of going from being killed by the sword of the Spirit, the sword of God, in the story of Christ and his crucifixion and the preaching of Christ crucified. But whoever dies in Christ rises in Christ. See him. There again, we resound the same theme that we have been putting out with Hebrews. See him now who has passed through the heavens. If he is there, what does it say? Let us therefore come. Come. Come up. Come up, saint. Come up, you who are slain on the ground. Come up, you who have been driven deep by this sword. Come on, you who are wounded and slain and have bled. Come on up, you who have fallen by the acknowledgement and the confession of your sin. And I think I see that in James. You may think that I have a great imagination, but isn't that what he's saying? When he talks about sin, does he not talk about death? Right? Verse 15, going back to James chapter 1, when sin is full grown, brings forth death. But, folks, after death, in verse 17, we have seen the downward movement, right? The movement of death. Confess your death, he's saying. But now we come to verse 18, and where is the movement there? Is it up or down now? Where is every good gift? Where does it come? Where does every good gift come from? From up. So he's saying, okay, look up. Now that you are down by looking and confessing your sin, look up, right? Because every good gift comes from me. Remember that he has brought you forth by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. So then, verse 19 and 20, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. This is very significant too. Remember what we said about this? Let every man be swift to hear. In other words, be slow to speak and be always what? Hearing. Attentive, right? Why? Because the flesh is always talking. Right? So, if we are not hearing from God, who are we hearing? Ourselves. Our own talk. And our own talk is drawing us away from God's talk. And if we're drawn away from God's talk, we are not being raised from the dead. We're left in our sins and trespasses, right? So it says here, that is why, and to me it is significant that he mentions Job, because that's what this attitude is one that Job had after Job has talked a big storm and tried to defend himself and accuse and try to get a hearing with God and all of that. Then Job says, I repent myself. I repent. And in his repentance, what did he do? Job 40 and 42. I have spoken once and twice, but now I put my hand over my mouth. I will say no more. You speak. So now the saint of God who is tempted in the trial of our faith, the sinner is faced with a choice. obviously, this is something the Spirit works, but those that have never heard the Word of God, and the Word of God has only been an external thing, will at some point reject it. And they will settle for their own talk. But those that inwardly have heard the voice of God will quiet their own voices and will hear the voice of God say to us, "Peace, be still, and know that I am God." And that is repentance and faith. So that then notice what happens. Let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak. And then what happens as a result of that? Slow to wrath. This is James 1:19. Slow to wrath. Wrath is anger, right? What happens to us when we don't get our way? What happens to us when things are not happening the way that we wanted? We get what? Angry. Now, be careful here, because anger can also be manifested as depression. I'm not talking now about clinical depression. Okay? Clinical depression has already brought an affectation of physiology. Okay? I'm talking about spiritual depression, which may lead to clinical depression. Okay? I'm making a difference there. But spiritual depression is anger against God maintained. Rebellion finally then turned inward. You could be angry at others, right? And put it out there and lash out. Or you could be angry how? Inwardly. And lash at yourself. And by lashing at yourself, also, what are you doing? Lashing at others too, right? Those that are around you, that care for you, that you have relationships with and all of that. So this has been called passive what?
Aggression.
Passive aggression. So God says to all of that, hey, listen to me. None of that works the righteousness of God. None of that works salvation for you. None of that works healing for you. None of that helps you. So he says it, verse 20, for the wrath of man, the anger of man, does not produce the righteousness of God. You see that? The righteousness of God. And then if you go on to the next verse, therefore, verse 21, lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness. How do I lay it aside? How do I lay aside all filthiness and overflow of wickedness as we have just described it? He has already said it. In a way, and he repeats it here. How? And receive with meekness the implanted word. Once again, receive the story. Huh? Receive the story with meekness. And notice that it's implanted, it's already in you. Listen to what God is telling you through the Word of God that's going to resonate with you, because the Word of God already lives in you, right? It's the implanted Word. Receive it with, what is meekness? Humility. Stop chafing under it. Stop rebelling under it. Stop resisting it. Soul, soul, it is a hard thing for you to what? To kick against the goads, right? Have you ever tried to kick against the goads? Right? Yeah, I have. I did once and almost busted my hand. Yeah. We do that in many different ways. Yeah. Or praise the Lord. For example, you have Jacob, right? Who was who before? That's right. That's right. Jacob, the supplanter, who becomes Israel. And Jacob was the one always what? He was the one that would work things in his own flesh, right? And what does God do? God draws him into the contest, into the battle, and God makes the wound, right? And Jacob, Israel, after that, forever limped. Praise God that he would make us limp, that he would put that limp in our lives, that he would put those marks of the cross in our lives. It's not some physical stigmata. It's not even some outward affliction. No, it's that inward suffering of the cross by which we are being put to death daily and being reshaped, remolded anew in the life and the resurrection of Christ, from whom we receive with meekness every good gift that his word in Christ speaks to us, right? Which is able to save your souls. And I think this salvation here is the healing of our souls. It's our sanctification life. It's our spiritual growth in Christ. So we may be saved, but if we're not in any way, shape, or form submitting to the Word of God, right? Either we are not saved, or we are saved, but we are this man that is, is fleshly, acts as if he was still in the flesh. As Paul would say to the Corinthians, you are carnal. And here I take issue with some great Bible teachers that have rejected this teaching, but I have to take issue with them because Paul says to the Corinthians, you are acting like mere men. You are carnal. That means a Christian can act as a carnal, as a mere man, as one who has not been regenerated. Obviously, where I agree with those that say there's no such thing as a carnal Christian is the fact that, yeah, the Christian has been born again and there will be fruits in his life. There will be good works. He has begun the process of sanctification, but even though there will be some fruit and there is some change, we can live and behave and act very much in a carnal way. And I'm sure all of us know that. And I don't know how those who say otherwise, I don't want to offend, but just to put it in a very benign way, would say that. Yeah. Now, in saying that, are we giving a license for sin? No. We're just acknowledging our battles. And we're acknowledging that, not just also our battles, that sometimes we're not fighting the battle. We become forgetful. We are completely swept away by our sinful desires and our idols. Thank God that will not be total and final, because God has a way of restoring us and disciplining us and all that. So in that sense, I agree that a Christian cannot be utterly and completely devoid of any affection of the Spirit because he has been born again. I agree with that. And we affirm that. Now, yeah, we must encourage those that are living as carnal to examine themselves. And when they examine themselves, What are they going to see? Their carnal ways. They're going to see their carnal ways. Now, by seeing their carnal ways, is that a way to conclude that they are not Christians? No, by no means. Look, when you examine yourself, and when you do, you're going to see your sin. Then the question is, do you see your remedy in Christ? And do you see the good gifts of the Father in righteousness providing for you? If you do, you are part of the family of God. Repent and turn and receive the word of God with meekness that can again go back and heal your soul further, purify your soul more, cleanse you more, sanctify you more, perfect you more. And this is goodness and blessing and healing for ourselves, for our neighbor, to the glory of God. Any questions? Well, we cover the same ground as last week. In a different way. You know what it's like? It's sort of like a hurricane that kind of says, okay, we're going to go away, but it comes back.
Don't make you feel any better.
Yeah, I just find another way of saying the same thing, and